Hello everyone, welcome to Triple Scoop. I'm Nolan, I'm here with Cheyenne, Sydney, and Chloe, and we're here to talk about a very weird movie, which is Saltburn. Great storyline, but some very weird scenes. Your guys' thoughts on the movie?
Cinematically, I thought this movie was beautiful. It was just, I loved like the tones of it and everything, and the cast was incredible.
Yeah. The cast? Loved them. I love them all.
Do you have a specific favorite?
I feel like everyone is going to say Jacob Elordi, but I love Barry Keoghan. I love him.
He had a good performance.
I thought he was fantastic.
Yeah, I thought he did a really good job. This cast, everything about this movie, great. I have seen this movie twice, one time with some of my suite mates and the second time with the remainder of my suite mates and Nolan, because I was like, after I watched it for the first time, I was like, I need everyone in my life to see this movie because it's just become my obsession. I went into it not knowing what it was. I found it off of TikTok, as I'm sure a lot of people who have heard the movie Saltburn is where they're seeing it, because that's where it got a lot of its popularity. And a lot of people were just freaking out over how disturbing this movie was. And I was like, what is this movie like? I went into it thinking it was like Call Me By Your Name.
Same.
Very wrong. Not at all like that movie. Cinematically, maybe. Content-wise, no. But I am a huge fan of this movie. I could watch it a third time. I may need a little bit more of like to space in between because I watched it twice in the span of like a month. But I'd watch it again.
I definitely agree that it was like a tremendous, is this the wrong word? A great, great movie. But I think they easily could have done it without those specific scenes, which are not, which is not PG. But the bathtub, that was something.
Yeah,
it was.
You could have easily just had him like just like kiss the girl too instead of.
Yeah, but you know what? I have some hot takes about this stuff. I honestly think that these scenes that people are like freaking out about, like, yes, they're a little bit like content mature, but he could have done a lot worse.
I feel like there's worse things in other movies.
There's so many worse things in other movies, like in the horror genre. Like this movie, I'm pretty sure it's like psychological thriller. Like it's not a horror movie, but like people are out here watching like slasher movies, and then they think that what Barry Keoghan does in this movie is like top 10 like worst things you can ever see. They leave so disturbed, and it's like, really? I don't think it's that bad. But look, I'm not saying that what he did is okay. What I'm saying is it could have been a lot worse.
What's worse than the corpse?
It wasn't a corpse, it was dirt. It could have been an actual corpse.
It's okay.
It could have been an actual corpse.
Everything in that scene, if it was just a dirt, you know, then it's fine.
But speaking of that scene, I actually learned that Barry Keoghan, that was not scripted. Like, yeah. That entire scene was improv, which I think is such a, smart is such a wrong word, because we're like, this isn't good. But it's like, it's so, it just speaks to, his acting abilities and his, yeah, you know, ability to make these character choices. Because honestly, it is something that I feel like Oliver would do, which, you know, he did. But the fact that he's like, you know what? Everyone get off the set. I have an idea. And then
wild.
Yeah.
It just happened.
Yeah. For how, like, disturbing it was, like, it did create so much depth to the character and just made you think so much more of, like, what went wrong in his childhood? Like, what brought him to this point?
True.
So, yeah.
Yeah. It was very shocking, though. Very shocking.
Yeah, nothing about this movie could have prepared me for where it was going to go. Like, I just knew there was this big estate.
Right off the bat.
Okay.
I told you 10 minutes in, and I said, what, is he going to get with every single person? And you just went,
Well, because I didn't want to say anything. But you were also, like, hooked on the butler. And I think that character is, like...
That was so weird, because the butler was, like, nothing in the movie.
I feel like they had the butler in there to be like a scapegoat character. I also was like, I don't know what this butler guy's doing here, because he was like freaky from the moment he's introduced.
Yeah.
But I think the film writers were trying to direct it as like, oh, he's like the person who's doing everything. They want you to feel bad for Oliver, even though after a certain point when you find out everything that's happened with his parents, you're like, is this actually like someone we should be feeling these feelings for? But the butler has been, you know, consistently just like this lingering like figure of creep, I don't know. But you were able to solve the mystery immediately, if you can even call it that. But I was like, Nolan, stop talking. You're ruining the entire thing. Just let it cook. Let the movie cook, all right?
I should be a movie writer. I already had it out before.
So then if you should be a movie writer, what would you replace the scenes with?
Ooh, that's a good question.
I don't know what I would change about the bathroom, but with the ketchup, I would just...
The vampire scene?
Yeah. I would just simply have him just, like, kiss her.
Okay.
And I really see the need of him having fun with the dirt. I mean, okay. Look, you can be emotional about it, obviously, but, like, not too emotional.
Not too emotional?
he made it very emotional.
Okay.
I thought at the end he was going to do something with the mom.
Yeah. I thought he was.
I thought he was going to do more.
Well, he probably did. They just didn't show.
Yeah. That, it could be up for interpretation. That's true. Well,
didn't he start, like, touching her up?
I don't think so.
I mean, I don't know. It's all I remember is him like pulling out her tube, like her breathing tube or whatever you want to call it.
That was a long tube. Yeah. Like when I saw it, I'm like, that's a huge tube. There's no need for it to be that long. Your lung is only there.
Well, yeah, it does. It has to reach your lungs. So it's,
the thing was like this long. It's like.
Look, man, I don't know. I closed my eyes when that happened because I'm like, that's...
But you open your eyes for the other scenes?
Wide open.
Yeah. Wait, I have a question.
Yeah.
So I saw the Mammoth Instagram. Was that was the scene,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
Shadow was doing the ending.
Yes.
Yeah.
The Great Hall is very Saltburn coded.
It is.
I will say that. Yes. And I honestly think that the Mammoth Instagram took great advantage of... that to have Shadow dancing around. However, if you know the scene, maybe it's a little bit like, should Shadow really be dancing around the Great Hall with this song playing like that? Yeah. But I mean, it was a great opportunity.
100%.
Yeah, but like,
I love that song though. Like, Murder on the Dance Floor.
Like I said, everything about that movie was just great, but. All movies come to an end, just like this segment. I'll see you guys next time.
Welcome back to another segment here on Triple Scoop. Now we're going to be covering music, new semester, new Coachella lineup. I'm Chloe here with Benicio, Jess, and Gabby, and we're here to cover this glorious lineup of artists right here. 3 days, 2 weekends each. Let's get this thing started off with Friday headliner, Lana Del Rey.
I love her to death. I love her. I would do anything to see her. Unfortunately, I cannot afford to go to Coachella. But she's an amazing songwriter, singer, everything. I love her.
I'm not going to pretend to be a Lana fan or anything, but from what critics say online, everything that Gabby just said is true, especially on the songwriting part. She's really supposed to be a musical poet.
She is.
I think it's well deserved for
Nicely
her to be on the
said,
first night of Coachella, headlining the first
Don't
night,
leave
I should
Gabby
say.
Just what do you have to say about Lana?
Yeah,
you fan?
I would say so. I don't know as much of her music as, you know, some, but I feel like she's definitely a vibe. I really like her style. She's very unique, and I feel like she's unapologetic about who she is. Definitely.
I feel like the one
confident.
Thing is a lot of her songs are like more slow and like quiet,
yeah.
So I don't know what she's gonna perform. I know she has like more upbeat stuff, but like a lot of them are collabs, so like unless she brings like The Weeknd out, because they have a lot of songs together, which I don't know if she would, but she has more like slower songs.
Yeah, that's what kind of like threw me off. I figured that she would like, you know, kind of fit into like the Coachella vibe a little bit, but as like a performer, like it's not that like super crazy, like upbeat, you know, type of thing that you get from like a rap artist or some of these other like pop musicians, like, because she's a lot more like mellow in her performance style. But I mean, I'm super excited for her and to see clips of her performance.
And I think her whole aesthetic is like peak 2015 Coachella.
Yeah, well, I think sometimes it can be a good thing to end with a concert or a music festival with slower songs.
Yeah.
It's she's just starting.
Everyone's kind of tired, chilled out by then. They want chill music. And I think that's why it makes sense to have her headlining the first night.
Mm-hmm. But I mean, there's some other artists on here that are pretty not chill. Benicio, I know you're pretty excited about Uzi being in this Friday lineup.
I am. I think there's a little bit too much backlash for Uzi after that Pink Tape album. I think Pink Tape was a great album. Maybe not as good as some of his earlier stuff, but it's gonna be hype having Uzi there. You know how hype the fans are gonna get when Just Wanna Rock plays.
Oh yeah.
EXO tour life is gonna go crazy.
And I will say this, I did notice Deftones was on the list of bands playing, and love their music too, but I think it would be so cool if Uzi did a song with Deftones. We already saw him do two songs with Bring Me the Horizon, so I think he should do a song with Deftones.
That could be cool.
Yeah.
Sabrina Carpenter is also performing. I feel like she's the new like uprising like pop star, even though she's been in the music for like a long time. But I feel like, especially for how much hype she has now, her name is like very low, kind of.
She's in like the second, underneath the headliner, like she's second here. So.
Like I feel like I don't know who Peggy is, but I feel like...
I feel like Sabrina Carpenter should be a little bit higher up than...
But I am very happy Tyler, the Creator is headlining.
Oh my God.
I love him.
I am ecstatic. Tyler, the Creator is back headlining Saturday's Coachella Day. I am so excited.
He's perfect for it. His performance is insane.
He has been in Coachella twice before, 2015 and in 2018. He's going to be doing a lot of stuff off of Call Me If You Get Lost.
Yes.
I should have worn my hoodie. I said this before, but huge Tyler fan. He's my number one Spotify artist, and I know for a fact he's going to rock that stage on Saturday, so I'm very excited to see what he does. But some other artists up here.
Ice Spice. And Sublime, which I think is quite interesting.
Yes.
Grimes, interesting.
I feel like it was smart of them to bring back like the older rock artists, like Sublime and Blur, because that brings a whole other
audience,
fan base. Like not just like younger people. You might get
millennials.
You know, or dads. I don't know. Like, you know, like
dads that brings of Coachella.
Yeah. I don't know.
Also, there was another person. Oh, Bleachers. What's interesting about that is Jack Antonoff is in Bleachers, and he produces for Lana Del Rey. So there could be something really cool happening with that. John Batiste, I know, is like, he won Album of the Year last year, and he's up again this year. I don't know any of his music.
I'm not familiar with his music either, but I was just going through the list here, and I saw Hatsune Miku is performing
on Saturday.
Oh my God,
that's crazy. She's like a hologram, right?
Yeah, she's a hologram, kind of like gorillas, but not, because it's she's like a Japanese.
That would be cool.
I feel like
a hologram perform.
I expect nothing less from Coachella. Like 100% on brand. Like, that's what I'd come to see, you know?
But moving off from Saturday, now we've got Sunday, headliner Doja Cat.
I feel like she's like cemented herself in the headlines of Coachella.
Yeah.
Even though she's controversial right now with like what her like vibe is, like.
Yeah, that threw me off a little bit. I saw her this past November at Prudential Center performing, and Ice Spice actually opened for her, which
was crazy. And this is a great performer.
Crazy. Ice Spice is an amazing performer. And so is Doja Cat, but after like everything that's happened, like with her release of her new album Scarlet, that has no features on it and kind of got a lot of like mixed reviews, and her whole like behavior on social media and everything, I was just like, you know, how are people gonna react seeing her on stage? But I mean, I know she'll kill it regardless.
I like that Lil Yachty's on the lineup. I like some of his stuff.
Same. I totally agree with you. I feel like he hasn't been talked about as much lately, and this concert could help bring him back into the spotlight.
Yeah, he's big on TikTok. He posts like funny stuff, I think.
That's what I hear.
He's friends with Tyler, the Creator, too.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. I think it could be really cool. Renee Rapp is also. I think this is her year.
Yes.
Like, genuinely between, like, Mean Girls and, oh, The Sex Lives of College Girls. Great show. I really think this is the year she's going to blow up because Snow Angel is such a good album. And I think she's really underrated. Like, I know she's gaining a lot of, like, followers, but I really think she's underrated.
Yeah, this is finally, I think her performing at Doja Cat is probably going to...
Yeah, and she was just on SNL.
At Coachella, excuse me. It's going to cement her as, and, like, the pop
star. And she has, like, fun songs and...
Oh, yeah.
Who else is on here?
Bebe Rexha.
No Doubt. Sorry, oh, I skipped ahead.
We'll wrap up with Sunday. Oh, wait, you wanted to mention another artist performing on Sunday.
Well, Taking Back Sunday is performing on Sunday. I mean, I'm not a huge fan of their music, but it's just interesting how they were able to throw one emo band in there.
Yes.
I think that's
nice.
Bring in
the emo crowd. I love that. 100% support that.
No doubt.
Gabby teased it a little bit, but I don't know if this falls under Sunday or if it's just like this own big thing, but they have this little thing underneath here that says, and No Doubt, which if you're unfamiliar with No Doubt, that is a like 90s alt like grunge band.
Gwen Stefani.
Gwen Stefani before Gwen Stefani became Gwen Stefani. So that is huge to see that, you know, are they coming back like
together? Their music is really good.
Oh, it's fantastic.
Spiderweb.
Don't Speak. Like, all of their music, super iconic, but yeah.
Stand and Deliver, like and I feel like Gwen Stefani is still like relevant and can perform
absolutely.
Well.
Absolutely.
Will she bring Blake Shelton out? We'll find out.
That'd be wild.
I think this is a fantastic lineup that we got here. Coachella, you've really popped off here. So we'll just have to wait until April to see how these performers actually shape up. So thank you guys so much for watching, and we'll catch you right back here on Triple Scoop. Welcome back to Triple Scoop. For our final segment of the day, we are going to talk about Scandoval, the Vanderpump Rules scandal that happened last season in honor of the 11th season coming out tonight. So, do you guys know anything about the show? Yes, no?
No.
No. I'm Gabby, by the way.
Oh, Gabby, Benicio, Luca, you know,
and
the
Kailyn.
Usual. Yeah, you should know me. Anyway, so, Scandoval. This was big. This is the biggest thing that's happened on the show, and the show's been on for 10 seasons. So I feel like it's kind of weird that it happened so late. But we're gonna get into the characters, and by the characters I mean the real people, but it's really fun. So, Ariana Maddox, she is a bartender at Sir, the place that they all originated, they all originated there, they all worked together.
Is it following a restaurant? Like,
yes,
the, place?
The show follows a restaurant of one of the Real Housewives of Beverly Hills, Lisa Vanderpump.
So, all right, so who are the Real Housewives of Beverly Hills?
I don't know all of them, I didn't watch the show. But Lisa Vanderpump is the one you have to worry about.
Because I remember these housewives raided the field of a Dallas Cowboys game in a football commercial.
Cowboys suck.
They do.
So
that was fantastic.
Is it a spinoff of that show?
Of Real Housewives of Beverly Hills? It's not necessarily a spinoff. It's more of just like a sister show.
Okay.
So like it has, Lisa Vanderpump is very like active in the show because it's her restaurant and it's her employees are in all this drama. But not all of the housewives will show up. It's basically just hers.
Okay.
So Ariana Maddox is a bartender. She started on the second season of the show, and she was dating Tom Sandoval for 9 years.
Wow. Before the show or during the show?
During the show.
Okay. Did they meet because of the show?
They got together. They met before the show started because they worked at another restaurant together.
Okay.
They got together after he cheated with her on his girlfriend, Kristen Doty. They were together for 6 years.
Did she work at the restaurant?
She worked at the restaurant. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 all worked at the restaurant. Tom Schwartz, he tried, he had a panic attack the first shift, and he stopped.
I get it. I worked at Chick-fil-A for 20 minutes. Yeah.
Understood. So they were together first. They made out at the Golden Nugget. Then they got together after. This was the whole arc of season 2 was her being like, why'd you cheat on me? But
were her and Ariana friends?
No, she hated Ariana. Ooh. Because of this.
Ariana, what are you doing here?
And she also cheated on him. So
How do we know that?
Because she admitted it.
Oh.
Before or after?
After? Yeah, after. But it was with her best friend's boyfriend. So that was a whole other mess.
That's the second season, whatever.
So, Tom Sandoval, best friends, Tom Schwartz, Tom. Tom Schwartz married Katie Maloney. They were together for 10 years. And they're best friends as well. So this whole little circle right here was like some of the main group of the first couple seasons. Now, James Kennedy comes in season 3. I forgot a line. Dating Kristen Doty. So they were together for a little bit, kind of messy.
That was a bad heart.
You know what, we're rushing.
Kind of messy.
He ends up
bringing Raquel. She goes by Raquel in the show. She's recently started going by Rachel again. Back in season 5, they started dating.
James and Raquel,
yes. So we got 2013 show airs, 2014 cheating scandal with Ariana. Then they start dating. They get engaged in May 2021. Tom Sandoval pays for the entire engagement.
The ring?
Like, the whole setup. And it was massive, too. Wow. It was a whole big, like, show. It was based on Coachella. Funny enough, since we just talked about it, they called it, like, Raquelchella, whatever. They
but are Tom and James, like, best friends? Or like?
They're very good friends. These are the stars. So they're very good friends. So it was like, oh, you know, that's so nice of him. That's so nice of him. But was it? Was it really just out of the goodness of his heart? No, he's a narcissist.
Oh, no.
So, December 21, they call off the engagement. They have a dog, too.
Where's the dog go?
Dog was split, and I don't know.
Split.
There was a whole other thing with the dog, too, after this happened. So there's, like, many layers.
I don't even know if we're going to get there.
My fault.
And then summer 2022 is when the affair begins. They lied, if we're going to jump forward a little bit. They've been saying, like, oh, you know, it was one time. Like, it was just, like, earlier. Like, it didn't happen, da-da-da-da. Like, they were just denying. They started at their friend's wedding.
James and Raquel?
Tom Sandoval and Raquel.
Wait.
Who was Tom?
At the wedding.
Okay.
At the wedding.
Which wedding?
Raquel's wedding?
Okay. No. Okay, Raquel and James called it off.
Right.
Tom, who paid for the engagement, and Raquel start hooking up.
Gotcha.
Yes.
Okay.
So at a friend's wedding in Mexico, they start hooking up, or that's the first time it happened, and they said
that's all that's happened.
But then...
And was James at the wedding too?
All of them were at the wedding.
Oh no.
But nobody knew. It's messy. And then Tom Schwartz knew about this. We find that out at the reunion. He admits it. But he knew that they had slept together. Their plan...
How do you know?
Because he admitted, because Tom told him. Because they're best friends, besties, more best friends than them. Okay. So Tom tells Tom Schwartz.
Tom Schwartz is such a basic name.
Tom Schwartz is quite the guy. He decides, you know what, I'm gonna take the heat off of my friend and like kind of misdirect everybody and kisses Raquel on the same vacation for the cameras. So they have a whole thing where, oh my God, this is fresh off of Katie and Tom's divorce, where she said, you can hook up with people, not my friends. What did he do? He hooked up with a friend. She's mad, rightfully so. I gotta do all the breakups. They're broken up now.
Oh, man.
That was a kiss.
Is anyone with anyone?
So what about James and Kristen?
Oh, they broke up, they were toxic,
You gotta scribble.
Sorry. So basically, then rumors start coming around about Ariana and Tom. Mind you, nobody knows about the affair. People know about the kiss with Tom Schwartz. Rumors coming around that Tom's saying, oh, you know, we have an open relationship, you know, like it's not a big deal. She's like, no, we don't. What are you talking about? We're trying to fix everything. He's like, it's going so bad. They were like, okay. Then March 2023, she finds out because she has his phone while he's performing at a concert because he's also a singer. Mm-hmm. Finds a video of Raquel.
Wait, who's the singer?
Tom Sandoval.
Is his music any good?
No. She has his phone because he dropped it.
Is he on the Coachella lineup?
Oh, thank God, no. A video of Raquel when they were on FaceTime. A video of Raquel.
Sus.
She calls Raquel up. Raquel's like talking to her. Their friend's like, oh, what's going on? She goes, I've been having an affair with Tom Sandoval for 7 months.
Seven
months.
Oh my gosh.
So then that was like a whole bomb. Everything went off. The press was everywhere. She now has a new boyfriend. May 2023, Raquel and Sandoval call it quits. She was like, she went
for good.
She went somewhere. She was sending him postcards. Then at the reunion, he gets called a poo-poo head and a worm with a mustache. Present, Ariana is now on Broadway. She was just on Dancing with the Stars, so she's living her best life. Sandoval just talked about Ariana today on a podcast, saying that she needs to stop talking about him. She's like, I don't. And Raquel has just done a new podcast to like rack in some more money about Scandal.
Oh, okay.
Overall, she's messy. And that's that. So thank you guys for tuning in to Triple Scoop. We'll see you next week. It's murder on the dance floor.
but you better not kill the groove. Hey, 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 it's murder on the dance floor, but you better not steal the moves. DJ, gonna burn this place.